Now we're getting into the area where people have real data. That's 45,000 years, 22,000 years on the screen. Let's look at this for a minute. This is worth talking about. Now the pressure begins to come on. It's all very well to predict interglacials that may or may not have occurred. Predicting assassinations of dynastic families is a little trickier. Here's the glacial melt begins. And species, this is the descent, this is where the mushroom paradise existed in its fullest expression, from about 17,000 years ago to about 10,000 years ago. Well, now what is this sudden interruption of the descent into novelty here? I maintain, based on the archaeological record, that it's what is called the Tanged Point Technocomplex. Do you all know what that is? Tanged Point Technocomplex means that before this point, when an arrowhead is found, you find one. It means it was lost by somebody who was hunting. Around 10,000 BC, you begin to find large numbers of arrowheads all in one place without chipping fragments. This was not an arrowhead factory. This was the site of a battle between human populations. War is invented here because agriculture is invented here. You're looking at the end of the partnership paradise. The era of orgy gives way to the era of anxious monogamy, warfare, agriculture, you know, egohood is born. Çatalhöyük, bottom of this stab here. The fire that burned through Çatal level 5A occurred in 6500 BC. We know this from charcoal dating. It's right there. It's on the money. See, somehow this whole Tang Point technocomplex bummer was overcome, and there was a steep descent into novelty. And Çatalhöyük was the product of that, but then it was destroyed and there was a rebound into chuckle-headedness for a while. And then right down here in the bottom of this thing is where the Great Pyramid is sitting. You know, the Great Pyramid was finished in September of 2970 BC. Why this should be so controversial, I do not understand, because there are grains of charcoal between the unmoved stones. That charcoal has not been anywhere since the day that stone was set in place. And it's 2790 BC. These people who want to push it back and say it's 10,000 years old, well, the obligation to prove is on them because the carbon radiological data argues. You see, there's some tendency in the New Age, which I don't understand very well, that wants to make everything older than it is. You know, the pyramids are 50,000 years old, Atlantis rose and fell 100,000 years ago. The miracle is how new everything is. The pyramids were built day before yesterday. Charlemagne was king of France early this morning. It's all very, very recent. I mean, the emergence of mind out of non-mind is an event practically on top of us.
Terence, Does the progression of time change its speed?
Yes, in a sense, because you see what happens is when you, it's a built-in mathematical property of this wave that when you get to the end of a big wave, there's, when you get to the end on any scale, there's a sudden drop to the next scale. And then it goes along to the end, and then there's a sudden drop. So if what we're saying is that a universe is made like, a universe that actually had this structure that I outlined for you, of 26 levels, where each level was 1/64th smaller than the level which preceded it, a universe built on that kind of architectonics would only be halfway through its life an hour and 35 minutes before the end. Do you see how that would work? That in the last hour and 35 minutes, it's going to go through as much development as it went through in the previous 72 billion years. So yes, time is accelerating into, we've gone from barely moving to approaching a staggering speed. And I maintain, that in 2012, the last 6 days preceding the approach to concrescence will be the jackpot. I mean, the laws of physics will break down. Everything will be in a state of visible, motile transformation. This isn't happening in the human world. It isn't happening in our minds. It's a crisis in the structure of physical law itself. And that's why this theory will be hard to disprove or prove until so close to the end date that you'll barely have time to make a telephone call to say whether it's true or not before, if it is true, your telephone call becomes totally irrelevant,
What you're essentially saying is that the fabric of space-time itself is being contorted, twisted, and...
Yeah, that's right. And if that seems unlikely to you, let's never forget what the Orthodox guys are peddling. They're peddling the Big Bang theory, which says the universe sprang from nothing in a single instant. I would prefer what I call the big surprise cosmology, because it seems to me if you have to have a singularity, the least likely place to find a singularity would be in a featureless high vacuum. If you want to find a singularity, look in a corner of the universe where there are planets, stars, elements, organisms, alphabets, civilizations, minds. In other words, look in a complex domain if you want to find a singularity. That's where you might have some chance of finding it. But finding it in an unflawed nothingness is a strange place to look, even.
Except one of the arguments maybe being proposed by those on the fringes that, in fact, it's a very complex universe that's been pushed through a membrane into the singularity, which then creates another entire...
Well, one possibility is that it's a wraparound, that we're not whistling Dixie when we talk about the archaic revival. What history is a finger reaching for the reset button. And when you finally touch it, you find yourself at the moment of the Big Bang. You've actually sent it screaming back to the first moment.
So this is an exercise in holographics, in a sense. That final 6 days is a very pertinent and potent holographic description of the whole baby, the whole...
That's right. And every cycle is a holographic description of the cycles that preceded it. So in 1945, when the bomb flickers into existence over Hiroshima, this is the resonance of the Big Bang. It's being caused by the Big Bang. And the entire life of the universe is then somehow reenacted in the remaining 67 years. In the same way, there was a 4,306-year cycle. We are reenacting that cycle in the present 67-year cycle. We have reached AD 700 right now. I mean, if you wonder why things are so benighted, it's because we're in the heart of the Dark Ages. You wonder why you can't understand the nature of the collapse of the state vector? Well, it's because you have an AD 700 intellectual machine looking at it. My God, the calculus hasn't been invented. Algebra hasn't been invented. The new world hasn't been discovered. These things will all happen ahead of us. Right now, we are in the heart of the Dark Ages. By the late 90s, we'll be closing distance with the Renaissance. Clearly, we have to put up with a bunch of Christer fundamentalism, epidemic diseases, and general knot-headedness until we get to that point. But then, after the turn of the century, we can expect the equivalent of the Renaissance, the Industrial Reformation, the rise of Napoleon, the Civil War, Adolf Hitler. It'll just be coming quick. And finally, you know, it just pulls you in and everything happens at once. One way of thinking of this is that the entire rest of the future history of the universe is being compressed into the next 20 years. But in other words, the heat death of the universe is 20 years away, essentially, is what is being suggested, because time is beginning to accelerate at such a rate that this compression factor is enormous. You know, Jeremy Rifkin wrote a book. Anybody read it? What was it called? Nobody read it. It was called... Anyway, the premise of the book was that time is accelerating, but he thought of it as social time, cultural time. I don't. I think it's embedded in the fabric of space-time itself. Yes, I think in a few... You see, you can only react to crises that you understand. So if I tell you the ozone hole is disappearing, you're alarmed. If I tell you an asteroid is going to strike the Earth, you're alarmed. But if I tell you that the Earth is about to collide with a hyperdimensional knot in the nexus of space-time, you know, but that's what's happening. Ahead of us is an enormous speed bump. We are colliding. We're about to collide with something that we can barely cognize, so it's hard to know what to think about it. Yeah.
This may be a little la-la and a bit simplistic, but consider this. You know, we all have experienced this sort of shifting of time and just the experience of one lifetime. You know, as a 2 or 3 year old, the moment as we experienced it seemed to last a longer period of time. I mean, my God, summer has lasted forever, whatnot. We don't have that. I mean, it's sort of... Well, that's what happens over the course of a lifetime. What happens if consciousness shifts out to infinity? What happens to the moment then? It becomes vanishingly small, or in terms of the frequency...
It stops. Yes, it's possible that dying takes forever.
Right.
You see?
That's the nature of a singularity.
And so, you know, you start to die, and then you die, and die, and then you realize you're going to die forever and never approach it, because the seconds become stretched into millions of years. It's something like that. It's about, and I think psychedelics are about the fabric of time. When you strip away the hallucinations and the personal reference and the craziness, the bare bones of it are, it's about time. It illuminates what time is.
Yes.
See, part of the problem with perceiving what's going on is that we're like mayflies or something. I mean, we live so briefly that to us it looks like the world is standing still, but in fact staggering amounts of change are going on. I mean, the automobile is 100 years old, for crying out loud. We can't conceive of a reality without the automobile. So, and just in my lifetime, you know, I've seen immense change. So, and this is going to accelerate eventually to the point where I believe they'll hold conferences on the acceleration of time, and boards will be appointed to try and figure out if anything can be done about it, and stuff like that.
I know you have a distaste for quantum physics, but there was a conference apparently last spring in Spain. Actually, it was a conference of astrophysics, I believe, because I heard some of the reports on it. And a serious topic of discussion was the fact trying to answer the question, does time exist? I mean, this was being serious on the agenda at some astrophysics conference.
Yeah, time is the great misunderstood or ununderstood quantity in our lives, for sure. Here, let's do a little more. We've got 22,000 years on the screen, 11,000 years on the screen, 5,000 and some. This is, in a way, my favorite screen, because this book I want to write, I'm going to call History's Fractal Mountain. And there it is, folks, History's Fractal Mountain. Chatalyayuk is over here in the bottom of this. Along this descending gradient here, like pearls on a string, you get the great ancient civilizations, Chaldea, Babylon, and Egypt. And this actually, the graph actually confirms the intuition of the theosophical mentality that Egypt did achieve some level of advance that was not surpassed until late Roman times. That there was a tremendous breakthrough on the part of these civilizations. This negative, habitual, or recidivist upward curve is studded with a whole bunch of warlike male dominator civilizations, the Hittites, the Mitanni, the Assyrians, and up here at the top, Mycenaean pirates overwhelm the last outpost of the goddess culture on Minoan Crete. This is Homer, right there. Homer sings his song. That to me fits because I had a professor who once said to me, "You want to know where it went wrong? I'll tell you where it went wrong. When these Greeks pulled their boats up on the shore and stopped being fishermen and started talking philosophy, the shit hit the fan." And that's precisely what happened. There it is. You see this steep, steep descent into novelty. And then after the fall of Rome, oscillation around a mean where it's sort of up, it's sort of down, but there's no real progress until the Industrial Revolution of the 1740s.
Well, that makes sense because any kind of attempt at descent into novelty or ascent into novelty would have been suppressed by the emerging church at the time.
Yes. That's right. Well, of course, this isn't Eurocentric. It's global.
Where does it go from BC to AD?
Oh, you mean where is the birth of Christ? There's a little kind of a choke and then a very steep fall right afterwards. That's the birth of Christianity, of the Roman Empire versus the Republic, and so forth.
I think that novelty has now gone to centered around human civilization.
Well, it wasn't at first, it was physical. It was that atomic physics gave way to chemistry, which gave way to molecular biology, which gave way to life. It keeps moving, it keeps being active at the front of the wave, but it leaves a residuum behind it of these previously created structures. Right now, the wave is clearly lodged in our species, while everything else is under the aegis of Darwinian mechanics. We're apparently under the aegis of cultural mechanics. It builds on complexity. Wherever there is complexity, you will get more complexity. It doesn't build on simplicity. It builds on the last most complex achievement, see? Now, pretty soon there is the descent. Here, let's stop and look. The crucifixion is right there. And it's interesting, you know, Christ was an absolute contemporary of Caesar Augustus. So you get this great religious reformer at the same time that you get the great reformer of Roman polity. So two of the most important personalities who ever lived are alive at that point. That, strangely enough, does not win the prize. See this deep little chip here? If we were to blow that up and look at the bottom of that trough, there was a moment when you could have had a dinner party when Lao Tzu, Confucius, Mencius, Pythagoras, and Ezekiel could have all gotten drunk together had they been able to find each other right back there in the immediately preceding the Greek Renaissance. Now, the fall of Rome is in 475, right there. And you see how the time after the fall of Rome is all of a certain general character, clear up to 1700. And then certain technologies and mathematical techniques propel to an even deeper level of novelty. Now, the next screen is the one that I think is probably where we either win or lose you.
Look at the overall shape of that wave. It's clear that there's an overlying principle at work here. I mean, the birth and death of Christ is practically noise on that curve. Well, it just points out that it's not being driven by what we would perceive as these...
No, it's not being driven by these great personalities. They are being driven by it. I'm sure that if you could have stepped into Christ's mind while he was undergoing the passion, the main question he was asking himself was, what is going on? You know, why do I say what I do? Why do I do what I do? I don't seem to be my own person. You know, I seem to be a puppet of some cosmic force, because he was a puppet of some cosmic force. You see, the transcendental object at the end of time is like one of those reflecto balls that hang in discos, you know? And as it turns and spins, it sends off distorted reflections of itself, which ricochet into the past. And if you are correctly situated, it'll turn you into a Christ or a Buddha or a Lao Tzu. If you're not quite correctly situated, it turns you into a Madame Blavatsky, a Meister Eckhart, in other words, second stringers. If you just get a little of it, well, then you're a person with strange insights and great personal charisma, and the people around you love you. We all are very close to this thing. Every night when you dream, you come into the presence of the transcendental object at the end of time. We are all distorted reflections of the last thing. And as we get closer and closer to the eschaton, the last thing, the distortion begins to leave. And you say, my God, it's like watching a photograph from an SX-70 develop. First it's just murk, and then you say, oh, there's a person there, and it's getting clearer and clearer. You know, we are actually being pulled into the attractor. The veils are being parted. The truth is becoming more and more and more imminent. And if in the final confrontation with it, you know, it's the apocalypse, the apotheosis, the apocatastasis, a whole bunch of Greek words beginning with A. Okay, now, this is the screen upon which the theory will stand or fall, because this is the screen that is filled with the history that we know. We're not talking fossil records or Chataljayuk or any of that. We're talking very precise dates. It's saying that there was a very steep descent into novelty around 948 AD. What is this? This first steep descent into novelty is the intellectual flowering of Islam within the confines of the Umayyad and Abbasid caliphate and the invention of algebra, an intellectual tool that sets the stage for modern science. Essentially, this is the birth of modern science, and you see how steep, sudden, and precipitous it was. Okay, then you go over to this next one. See, I'm moving the little pointer, and it's telling me exactly what I'm pointing at. 1121, the First Crusade, the collapse of fortress Europe. This is the beginning of the globalization of the European mind. We're dead on here. Okay, now the next steep descent into novelty is this one, obviously. Let's go over there and see what it is. It's 1354. What happened in 1354? That's right. One-third of the population of Europe dies in an 18-month period beginning in late 1354, the greatest demographic collapse that Europe has ever experienced. It's an absolute hit, dead on. Now let's go over here. to this. Now notice, though, that the recovery is quick. There's a steep descent into novelty and an almost immediate reversion back up to the same level of habit, exactly, business as usual. But this next one is different. It's a steep descent into novelty, and then it really stays down for a long time and explores this. So let's go over to the turning point, which is up at the top. The world is now dominated by European values and culture. So while we can chart the ebb and flow of the Han Dynasty, at this point, European culture is moving to the fore because European culture is beginning to put its imprint on all of world history.
But you also can't forget this is a superposition of many different factors.
That's right. This is a picture of a resonance pattern, an interference pattern of many times and places. Now, up here at the top of this thing, it's 1455. What happened in 1455? Does anyone know? What? Columbus was born? Thanks for playing. In 1455, Constantinople fell to the Ottoman Turk, making European access to the Far East impossible. Therefore, the age of exploration begins, and you get Vasco da Gama and all those people. This was a tremendously shattering event for European civilization to lose Constantinople to the Ottoman Turk. Now let's go over back, to this place. This is another very seminal event, which combined with this Constantinople loss sets the stage for this descent into novelty. Even though it's way up here in habit, there's a little chip out as there's a novel invention of some sort that happens in 1540. 1440, I'm sorry. The invention is the invention of printing in Mainz in 1440. That did it, friends, as far as most people are concerned. But what I'll fudge by telling you that up here, 1455, down here, 1492, along this screaming descent into novelty are all the painters of the Quattrocento. This is the Italian Renaissance, this descent into novelty. And this is the era of exploration, 1492. Good, huh? Good, good. The absolute thing is in 1485, and all the painters of the Italian Renaissance are along this thing. Now, notice that in 1492, there isn't an instant rebound. There's 1492. But instead, because the lost half of the planet has been discovered, this sets off the age of discovery. And habit is unable to reassert itself because too much peculiar data is flowing in. Too many new lands, peoples, materials, philosophies, alphabets, languages, sexual styles, cuisines, and it's like they're overwhelmed. However, after a while, they get their act together and manage to turn it into hell itself. Right there, what ends the era of discovery and optimism and psychedelic exotica is the 30 Years' War. The 30 Years' War begins in 1619. It ends in 1648. It begins with Europe medieval. It ends with Europe modern. Parliaments have replaced popes and kings. The whole name of the game has been changed. Now, the 30 Years' War lasts, as I said, until 1648. At the bottom of this cut in here, which is in a situation of rising habit, there nevertheless is a strong tendency toward novelty, reaching a culmination in 1677, Newton publishes the Principia. The celestial mechanics are put on a firm basis. The calculus has been invented. The world of modern science is now completely in place. And aside from the 30 Years' War, what Europe is exporting to the rest of the world on this hellish upswing is slavery, the patron system, forced labor, brutal return to habitual methods of the past. You may not know that slavery died with the fall of the Roman Empire. If you owned a slave during the medieval period, you owned one slave. It was a house slave, and it proved, your ownership of this person proved that you were a person of immense wealth. It would be like owning a beach bonanza today. It's beyond owning a Rolls Royce. But the need for a drug, strangely enough, the drug being sugar, reversed this, and in the 1440s, they began buying Africans and taking them to the Canary Islands to work sugar. So the moral power of Western civilization could not stand in the way of the reestablishment of slavery and the sugar trade. Now, up here at the top of this thing, there's a twist, a turn right there. In 1739, this is the European Enlightenment. The European Enlightenment was the great intellectual step that set the stage for secular civilization, people like Voltaire. And out of that came two revolutions. Well, the Inquisition would have been, I presume, a fairly unnovel thing. Since what it was a power group torturing the helpless, which there's nothing new in that, for heaven's sake.
It went on for a long time, too. Wasn't
it? Went on for a long time, but actually it was a Spanish phenomenon. It was confined geographically to a very small number of places. Right there, August 1st, 1776, the American Revolution takes place as a consequence of this steep descent into novelty at the beginning of the European Enlightenment. Well, as you know, the American Revolution is generally thought to have had a happy conclusion. The French Revolution, not so happy. And if you explode that area and look, you can see that they're happening on different slopes of this thing. Then the restoration of Louis Napoleon in 1803 is there. This bump is the American Civil War and the Franco-Prussian War, which were the first modern wars and completely distorted the demographics of the United States and Europe. Now let's look at the 20th century. And this is, remember how I said that the Great Pyramids were at the bottom of this trough at a higher level? Now we're seeing the same pattern again. What we get at the bottom of this trough here is the Third Reich. And to show you how the resonances work, think about the Third Reich in relationship to ancient Egypt. First of all, probably the word Führer can be traced to the word Pharaoh. This is the same concept of a master leader. In addition, the Third Reich and ancient Egypt shared an obsession with large-scale, tasteless architecture. In addition, both civilizations had a real tendency to lean on the Jews. So you see, you get this strange kind of microscope on a historic. I mean, most people, I think, would not associate ancient Egypt to the Third Reich. And yet when you begin listing the similarities, you see in a way one is a reflection of the other. Okay, within the 20th century, this is somewhere like 1903. Einstein was in 1905, the general theory, I think. Which came first, the general or the special?
Special.
Special came first in 1905, and the general came slightly later. Down here in the bottom of this trough, let me show you. Right there, Hitler becomes Chancellor of Germany. And then all of World War II is fought in the bottom of that trench. Here's 39. Here's August 39. That's June. That's September. So that's when it begins. And see how, even though it's a novel situation, because it's a war, it's a recursion to habit. So at the bottom of a trough of novelty, you get a little upward pimple of recursion to habit. Then, there it is. That's Hiroshima right there, and Nagasaki right there. The war ends, and novelty is left behind. And remember that the psychology of the post-war mind was everybody wanted things to just get back to normal. I mean, certainly the Europeans wanted things to get back to normal. Their whole scene had been bombed into the Stone Age. And in this country, people just wanted to get their place in the suburbs and marry the girl next door and have a slew of kids and buy a Chevrolet and forget about, you know, thousand-year millennial plans and all the rest of it. And so this is the post-war, Cold War era. And it lasts, let's look, oh, there's 1952. Here's the launching of Sputnik is there.
It was 59.
No, October 1st, 1957. A day graven on my mind till they lower my box. The first American satellite was launched right around there, Explorer 1.
Did you show the first Death concert?
Give me the date. Okay, there's the assassination of John Kennedy, as close as I can get it at this resolution. If I go back one, I'm before it. So you see it's right at the bottom of that steep stab that takes place against this other thing. What turned it around? You mean what's the turning point? I thought you'd never ask.
Yeah. And when is it?
Oh, I'm about to get it for you. There it is, August 1967. It's the summer of love. Not only does this thing illuminate history, it also, fulfills my deepest inner delusions. So. And remember I said when we were looking at history's fractal mountain that this was Homer up here? So then you can see that the freak thing, the hippies, were like the pre-Hellenic Greeks. I mean, all that bralessness and loose-fitting clothes and tambourines and ecstatic bacchanalian with a philosophical undertone. I mean, it was a Greek mentality that broke out in 1967. Well, then here's the long descent into, you know, the dreary present moment, and Richard Nixon getting the axe. Yeah. Now we're into the Reagan era down here. That's the last 11 years. Now, see how tight it has to be to work. Remember that we've been looking at this thing from, we've descended from 6 billion years to 11 years. We have predicted asteroid impacts, glaciations, speciations, the rise and fall of empires. Now we're down to the short and curly, I would think. Let's take a look at what it is. Now, let's see, when was George Bush elected president? 88. So it would have been November 88. That's October. That's November. Now, what is the resonance to that moment? I don't think of it so much as Bush being elected as Reagan leaving office. The resonance here is the fall of Rome. Rome falls right there. Well, then see, we have a series of high and low points, which we should be able to correlate to recent catastrophic or world-changing events. So let's play the game. What's happening down here for the 30 days preceding that day is a million people are camping out in Tiananmen Square. At the very bottom of the trough is the night that they had the most people in the square. And then it turns upward, as you can see, because the constipated fascist oligarchs in charge of that society were preparing to do murder. And there's nothing novel or new about murder. It's the oldest game in the book. So that went on there. Then the next steep descent into novelty is right there. Who knows what happened very close to 11/11/89? The Berlin Wall fell down. Germany is unified right there. So Tiananmen, Germany, then a bummer of some sort. And what is that bummer? It's the Romanian Revolution, which, as you'll recall, was handled in the Messier style, where you put people up against walls and machine gun them and so forth and so on.
Harmonic Convergence, that was August 87.
Oh, you want to see the Harmonic Convergence? Give me the date.
August
887. There is as close as we can get. What it shows that a long descent into novelty that had previously been impeded, but there isn't anything particularly special about that date, but it does fall in the domain of going over this hump. Over here, you'll recall the Gulf War and all that. Here's how that looks. Okay, now, look here. August 3rd, 1990. There's where Saddam Hussein invades Kuwait. It's also where Mohammed is born, one level up. Now, remember how after he invaded, then there was a lot of breast beating and armies being moved into position and so forth. That goes on. There's a steep descent into novelty, which then is slightly moderated, and at the kink is where the war begins. War is a kind of ambiguous thing. War is a habitual activity, but it does cause novelty, especially technological novelty. So, you know, that's why it's nice that you can blow up these waves and see the variations within the theme. And now the next one is really intriguing to me, and I'll show you why. There it is. It's February 21st of this year, and it's the lowest point of novelty for this year. Now, I was really puzzled by this because I watched very carefully that week, and there didn't seem to be anything very novel going on. My book did come out, you're right, but I was modest enough not to place that in a context of world history.
It's certainly more important than the drug summit that was there.
Well, you know what happened? And this leads us to the slippery edge of prophecy. There was an event which happened, not on the 21st of February, but on the 20th, which may be trivial and forgettable and absolutely not worth talking about, or may be one of the most important events in the history of the 20th century. Do you know what it was? Ross Perot goes on Larry King and offers a suggestion about his availability for the presidency. Now, if the guy fades and becomes a nothing burger, it doesn't count. But he does have the wave blowing at his back, that's for sure. So that's basically it. If you want to see, let's look at the future. Target date, month, let's do today. Today is the fifth month, 31st day of 1992. Now let's choose the time span, 10 years. So it's pointing at today.
What's the time span?
10 years. The last five, the next five. And what it shows is that we are actually, as if you didn't know, exploring a very deep trough of novelty. It will last until August 93. Uh-huh. The thing to keep your eye on is this, which is such a spectacular drop. I mean, look how much weirdness we've been through, but it's taken us this much time to do it. This sucker is going to do it in a 3-month period in early 96. So that's the idea. Now, the notion is that, remember how I kept talking about how a cone contains all possible ellipses and you section it? What the psychedelic experience is a sectioning of eternity. And you can build up a picture of the cone by sectioning eternity sufficiently that you get a map like this. I mean, I'm convinced by this that time is fractal, that instead of treating time as a zero quantity, as the Newtonian equations do, or as a very gentle curvature, as the Einstein equations do, that we have to sub in this fractal dimension, and that this will make possible a science more powerful relatively to present science, as present science is through the power of the calculus to Greek science. Time, about which we previously knew next to nothing except that it seemed to keep happening, can actually be described in the same way that energy and other factors in the universe can be described. Now, the last thought I want to leave you with is I don't think anybody could make this up. Certainly not me, a person with no training in mathematics, no interest in this kind of thing. I was told this stuff. And, you know, most, God forbid, channeling is of the horrible variety, which tells you to, you know, eat brown rice and love your neighbor. You don't need channels to tell you that. You have channels in your own head which tell you that. This is a mathematical equation. I mean, it's embedded in a lot of rap, but the real channel is an equation for the description of time, which makes assertions, makes predictions, is willing to be held to mathematical analysis, all the things scientists are always screaming that occultists never will provide them with their theories, this provides. So I'm willing, since it's only one person's life, I'm willing to preach this a little bit, because I'm not, see, the choice here is pretty stark. Either I'm nuts or I'm Newton. There's no in between. Because there is no in between.
It's binary.
Yeah, it's definitely it's right. I'm the greatest intellectual synthesizer in the history of man. If I'm wrong, it's just horseshit. So then the question is, which is it?
When did you first publish?
I figured this out. There were many, it took a long time, but from 1971 to 73 is when I figured it out.
Okay, so what was happening at that time down
here?
About here.
Here to, let's see, let's go back, let's go there and see. Well, let's point it at this little dip here, giving me the benefit of the doubt, and say that it was January, February, March, April 26, 73. I'm sure that had you visited me in April 26, 73, you would have found me hunched over graph paper and working furiously. Now let's see what the resonance of that is. 526 BC. Oh, it's the Greek Renaissance. It's Plato, Pythagoras, Ezekiel, Confucius, Lao Tzu. Hey, I think it's time to knock off. You should quit when you're ahead, you know? Yes.
Most of my leftist scientific discoveries, nature provides us with redundancy. I'm thinking of calculus. I'm thinking of atomic bombs. They're usually developed in parallel, several sites on Earth. Just an observation. There's no parallelism here.
Well, in a sense, there... No, wait a minute. In a sense, there is. This is a fractal. It was invented or channeled by me before fractals became the absolute obsession of frontier mathematics. Now everybody wants to talk about fractals, and everybody says, you know, population growth, river mouths, everything can be modeled by fractals, but nobody has said time can be modeled by a fractal. So I think probably the rise of fractal mathematics is indicative of this. The other thing is, this could never have been brought to the public without small personal computers. I developed this finished it in 75, and in 77 they began selling small computers. It's a weirdness, it's a hallucination, that's what it is. My dream has always been to bring something here from there. And apparently the only things which travel well from there to here are ideas. And I'm not an artist, so I couldn't paint. So this is a psychedelic idea. I think there are millions of these kinds of ideas swimming in the psychedelic ocean. Yeah.
The second thing that strikes me about this is what good does it do us? And if it's true, I don't want to know it. I would like to hide from this if you're anywhere near correct.
Well, that's because we really haven't talked about the nature of the concrescence. You know, what is this all argues for an impossible conclusion, that the world is going to disappear up its own wazoo at dawn, December 22nd, 2012.
Can we see it on the screen?
What?
2012.
Oh, you want to see the last day? Yeah, I'll show you the final thing. Okay, the pointer will be pointing at Jan 1, 2010. But you see, there it is. It runs down. He don't go no more. That's the end. Now, I have created one way out that preserves the theory and a rational universe. And it is simply this, that what happens on December 22nd, 2012 is that time travel is invented. And because it is invented, it is no longer possible to portray historical data on a linear graph.
Yes.
So that's all. It's just, it was a thing about technology, and eventually a technology was created which made the three-dimensional space-time matrix itself obsolete.
Well, it's just a dimensional octave jump.
Yes, dimensional octave
so
jump.
The transcendental object?
The transcendental object is the despair of description. It cannot be known. It can only be approximated. It's the sacred heart of Jesus. It's the flying saucer. It's the philosopher's stone. It's tantric union. It's good LSD. It's all of these things and more. It transcends language and understanding, but the closer we get to it, the more it will be revealed. And the reason the 20th century is so peculiar is because we're so close to the zero point, we're so close to the transcendental object that, you know, take a hit, there it is. Close your eyes and daydream,
yes.
There it is. Have an orgasm, there it is. It's trying to break through. It's almost upon us. We've been sailing toward this thing for 72 billion years, and we are now 22 years from impact. The walls are so steep. The acceleration is so great. We are there for all practical purposes. And then what spiritual life and headdom and all that means is realize that we are there so that anxiety drains from your life, body, and worldview. And then you just ride the wave. And when people talk of catastrophe, revelation, salvation, and destruction, you just smile a small smile, knowing that it will be all that and more and more and more. It's something, I think it's to reassure us. You see, I think the world is going to get hip to the fact that we are actually caught in a whirlpool in time that is sucking us into another dimension. Without something like time wave zero, a notion like that could get fairly alarming and spread a lot of panic. With time wave zero, you just say, look, we have a map of what's going on. We'll check off the milestones. As long as the wave keeps working, nobody should freak out. Just settle in, hang on, and we'll navigate through this. So it's a vital piece of knowledge necessary to face the eschaton without panic. Because these crazy religions want to tell you that you're going to be judged and damned and fired and roasted. No, no, that's not it. They got the story wrong. We're just being sucked into hyperspace. And hyperspace is the human imagination, the human heart, the human soul. It's the domain of our dreams. Our imagination is a flickering image of what it will be. But what it really will be is the despair of prose. What it will really be can only be approached in silent darkness on 5 grams. And then you can't tell anybody about it. Thank you very much.
This concludes In Search of the Original Tree of Knowledge, a weekend workshop with Terence McKenna. Music by Stephen McNamara. For additional copies of this audio learning series, or to receive a free catalog of wisdom teachings for the inner life, please contact Sounds True, www.soundstrue.com, or call us toll-free, 1-800-333-9185. Or write the Sounds True catalog, P.O. Box 8010, Boulder, Colorado 80306. Thank you for listening.